गया था तुम्हारा वो?
Hello everyone. I'm Dr. Sapna Dadwal. I'm working as a professor in the Department of Management at St. Andrew's Institute of Technology and Management. This is lecture 16 of Business Law of Unit 3. This subject is taught in BBA 4th semester. In the earlier lectures, I have discussed the contract of agency. But now, in this lecture, I'm going to discuss Sale of Goods Act 1930. So the topics I'm going to cover in this lecture are Sale of Goods Act 1930. I'm going to give introduction of this act. Then I'm going to discuss salient features of the act, essentials of sale of contract, then difference between sale and agreement to sell, difference between sale and hire purchase, then meaning and definition of goods, classification of goods. These are the topics I am going to cover in this lecture, lecture number 16 of Business Law of Unit 3. Now I am starting with first introduction of Sale of Goods Act 1930. The Sale of Goods Act 1930 was enacted to enable the parties to know their mutual rights and obligations in transactions involving sale or purchase of goods. The Act also helps to understand validity and the remedies available to the aggrieved parties. So the Sale of Goods Act deals with sales but not with mortgage or pledge. The Act deals with goods but not with other movable property like actionable claims, money, etc. The Act does not deal with movable property other than goods and immovable property. The scope and object of the Act was, the Act deals with goods but not with other movable. I have already told you this. And this Act extends to whole of India, and it came into force on 1st day of July 1930. Now, the salient features of Sale of Goods Act 1930. This Act lays down the rights and duties of buyers and sellers. This Act lays down the conditions of valid sale in the eyes of law. This Act lays down the express and implied conditions and warranties under a contract of sale. Now, the definitions which are given in Sale of Goods Act 1930. Some definitions I am going to discuss here. As per the section 2.1, a buyer. Buyer means a person who buys or agrees to buy goods. Then delivery. The word delivery in Sale of Goods means, in section 2.2, delivery means voluntary transfer of possession from one person to another. Then deliverable state. Goods are said to be in a deliverable state when they are in such state that buyer would under the contract bound to take delivery of them. Then documents of title of goods. So documents of title of goods include a bill of lading, dock warrants, warehouse keepers, etc. Now the definition of word goods in the Sale of Goods Act. So goods means every kind of movable property other than actionable claims and money. Now the word price means in Sale of Goods Act. Price means the money consideration for a sale of goods. Seller, the word seller means sell, a person who sells or agrees to sell goods. So these are few words or meaning of words as per the Sale of Goods Act 1930. Now, meaning and definition of contract of sale of goods as per section 4.1. So, according to section 4.1 of the Sale of Goods Act 1930, a contract of sale of goods is a contract whereby the seller transfers or agree to transfer the property in goods to the buyer for a price. So there may be a contract of sale between one part owner and another. So contract of sale may be absolute or conditional. Now the next topic is essentials of sale of contract. There are two parties, goods, price, transfer of general property. These are the points of essentials of sale of contract. Now I'm going to discuss these in detail. I'm starting with the first. Two parties. So there must be two distinctive parties, that is a seller and a buyer in a contract of sale. Seller means a person who sells or agrees to sell goods. Buyer means a buyer, a person who buys or agrees to buy goods. Now the second one is goods. There must be some goods. Seller must be selling goods and a buyer must be agreed to buy the same. So according to section 2.7, goods means every kind of movable property other than actionable claim and money. And that means goods. So both buyer and seller, they should agree to buy or sell the word goods here. Good is very clear from here. Now the price. So the consideration for a contract of sale must be money. Consideration called the price. So there should be some consideration. If there is no consideration, then there will not be a contract of sale of goods. So price or consideration. Consideration in the form of price should be there. And now fourth one is transfer of general property. The property here means ownership. So transfer of property in the goods is another essential of contract. To constitute a contract of sale, the seller must either transfer or agrees to transfer the property in goods to the buyer. Now the next one is essential element of valid contract. The contract of sale of goods should have all the essentials of valid contract, like party to the contract must be competent to contract, consent must be free and genuine, and object of the contract should be lawful, etc. These are the essential elements. Essential elements of a valid contract I've already discussed in my lecture one. You can see there, you can read from the lecture one, or you can listen lecture one again for the essential elements of valid contract. So it is very clear essential, what are the essentials of sale of contract. The first one is there must be two parties, buyer and seller. There must be exchange of goods, exchange of movable property other than actionable claims and money. Then there must be a consideration in the form of price, and then there must be a transfer of general property, that is in goods, and their contract of sale must have all the valid essentials of the valid contract. Now, difference between sale and agreement to sell. Agreement to sell. Sale is where under a contract of sale, the ownership of the goods is transferred from seller to buyer. Whereas agreement to sell is a contract of sale under which the transfer of ownership of goods is to take place at a future date. In sale, the ownership and property in goods passes to buyer immediately at the time of making contract. Whereas in agreement to sell, there is no transfer of property at the time of making contract. So in sale, the property in goods passes to the buyer, so risk also passes to the buyer. Whereas in agreement to sell, since property has not passed, so risk too stays with the seller. Now, difference between sale and hire purchase. Sale, all contract of sale are governed by Sale of Goods Act 1930. So whereas in the case of hire purchase agreements, these are governed by Hire Purchase Act 1972. So, sale is a contract of sale, whereas hire purchase, it is an agreement of hiring goods. Whereas in sale, possession of goods need not necessarily be transferred immediately. Whereas in hire purchase, possession of goods is transferred immediately. In case of sale, ownership of goods is transferred immediately. Whereas in hire purchase agreement, ownership of goods transferred on the payment of last installment. Until last installment, the ownership remains with the seller. Now, the next topic is classification of goods. Definition of goods I have already discussed. Now, classification of goods. The contract of sale is made to transfer of property in goods. The goods are the subject matter of contract. So, the goods are classified into the following types. The first one is existing goods. The goods which are physically in existence and which are in seller's ownership are called as existing goods. Existing goods are of three types. The first one is specific goods. Goods identified and agreed upon at the time of making of contract of sale are called as specific goods. It may be noted that in actual practice, the term ascertained good is used in the same sense as specified goods. Now, the second one is ascertained goods. Goods are said to be ascertained when out of masses of ascertained goods, the quantity extracted for and set aside for a given contract. Then these are called as ascertained goods. Now, unascertained goods. The goods which are not separately identified or ascertained at a time of making of contract are known as ascertained goods. For example, if A agrees to B one bag of sugar out of lot of 100 bags lying in his godown, it is a sale of unascertained goods because it is not known which bag is to be delivered by A to B. Now, the second category of classification of goods is future goods. So, future goods means goods to be manufactured or produced or acquired by the seller after making the contract of sale. So, there can be an agreement to sell only. There can be no sale in respect of future goods because one cannot sell what he does not possess. For example, X agrees to sell to Y all the crops to be grown at his farm in the year 2000 for a sum of rupees 1 lakh. This is an agreement to sell future goods and not a sale. So third classification is contingent goods. These are the goods the acquisition of which by the seller depends upon the contingency which may or may not happen. For example, X agrees to sell to Y all the crops to be grown at Z's farm in the year 2000 for a sum of rupees 1 lakh. If Z sells the same to X, so this is an agreement to sell contingent goods because the availability of crop depends on its sale by Z. Now, these are the questions which are related to above topic. If there is any query, you can always contact me. So, please. Thank you so much.